Home on a quarter-acre block of land was the Australian dream. But it was a subdivided dream, usually split on lines of gender. At the weekend, the yard was the Australian male's territory. He had only a few duties in life. He was expected to be a good provider and to service his wife and his Holden car on a regular basis.
You know, I think General Motors are marvellous, don't you? I think they're absolutely gorgeous. I mean, letting us call it Australia's own car. Do that? Such a wonderful gesture.
The kitchen was the domain of the Australian female.
The kitchen was the hub of our home. It was Beryl's domain. Above the stove, where we had a picture of a kookaburra on the door, there was a ledge, and there was a door of condiments in different sized tins. There was the flour, the sugar, self-raising flour, and the big tin. No, the plain flour and the self-raising flour, and the rice, and the sugar, and then there was the tea and the coffee. Though we didn't go in for the coffee, it wasn't our cup of tea. We tended to have, if we were so required it, the coffee essence with the chicory. And she used that tin for the desiccated coconut. Though, of course, there was a tragedy in the 50s when a boat carrying desiccated coconut to Australia discovered that they had a leper on board. Oh, terrible thing. But they had to dump the lot in the bottom of the sea. But for a whole generation, coconut was off the market due to the leprosy. And that generation missed out on Lamingtons. And they're the ones who are giving us the trouble now.
While husbands went to work, housewives did just about everything here. In kitchens like this, she cooked three scrumptious meals a day. She washed up afterwards. She planned sophisticated cocktail and slide evenings. She listened to the wireless and slowly but surely went totally insane.
Porsche faces life.
The rehabilitation training scheme ward is hardly a ward at all. Part of it, in fact,
fortunately, the Australian authorities had a modern mental health scheme to deal with the downside of domesticity.
Inside, there's a normal house, resembling as closely as possible the scene of pots and pans that Mrs. Hall will have to deal with when she goes home. A lesson in makeup helps Margaret feel light-hearted and feminine again. Then comes the big step. A voluntary worker takes her to the supermarket to do the shopping for the group. It's a tough ordeal. But she's managed it. What courage on her part.
Nobody suffered from shopping stress on Sundays. The shops were firmly shut.
There are 24 hours of sunshine every day that you're in love.
Australia went to the beach. Each weekend, lemming-like, we answered the call of the sea. Bodies were bronzed, families were bonded, and we all disappeared under a layer of salt and zinc oxide.
There are 24 hours of sunshine every day that you're in love. There are
24. Strangely, the beach also provided an opportunity for Australians to enjoy their post-war craving for regimentation. The same urges were catered for on sports fields and in schoolyards, where young muscles could be flexed that would never be flexed again.
There are 24 hours of sunshine every day that you're in love.
Well, you bow to your partner.
Give us a strict tempo and we were happy to fall into step. It started with Jim Vickers Willis and the square dance craze, which swept Australia early in the decade. And hit rock bottom with the introduction of the Mary Goo.
Mr. Campbell's really in a hurry to teach Australians a new dance. He's met by his attractive wife, Sue, and they're all set to make Melbourne rock and roll with a South American step they call the Mary Goo. Tight skirts and jeans are out for you, hepcats.
We were a very eager and accommodating nation. Only too delighted to be the guinea pigs for a new South American dance craze or an imported British atomic explosion. We were happy and even grateful that we had been chosen.
Only seconds to go. Eyes turn from the dazzling flash, Sir William Penny waits.
Let the rain fall, the night fall, anything that might fall, here's one thing.
We have seen the rise of Australia as a great nation, taking her full share in the councils of the British Commonwealth and of the world. I am proud indeed to be at the head of a nation that has achieved so much.
Far more traumatic than nuclear fission was any split in the nuclear family. From countless front doors, Australian mothers of the 1950s waved goodbye to their children as they went to school.
Bye, 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 my baby.
For their daughters, it was home economics or shorthand typing, skills to equip them for their brief span of independence between the leaving certificate and the marriage certificate. When school days were over, once again mothers stood on porches, waving goodbye to their sons. This time they were off to national service. This happened to me. This wasn't the real army, of course. There was no risk of actually being killed. However, I didn't relish my 3 months penal servitude at Pakapunyal military camp, 70 miles from Melbourne. Pakapunyal, by the way, is an Aboriginal word meaning land of the outer barbarians.
Right into bed, lads. Lights out. That includes you too, Curl.
Good night, boys.
Good night, chaps.
Good night.
By the end of the 1950s, we were ready to graduate to a new Australia. The Australia of the 60s. Hairier and scarier.